Good morning. Saturday morning. I want to do something. Seems my video delayed a couple seconds or so. I'm not exactly sure why, but
I'm sitting in my kitchen. I just called the police a few minutes ago and to come and take a report, but for some reason or another, the police chickened out and they ran. And I guess when I show you this image, it will basically explain the reason why they ran. They wouldn't come into the apartment. I was praying earlier on my knees. Basically, I'll show you exactly what I was doing. My chair, where I usually sit and do work. It's a really interesting image where I usually sit and do work, and I decided to turn it around and to pray. And so this was basically how the chair was set up. I'll show you. The chair was set up this way. It's a green chair, right? So check this out. Okay, so this is the chair where I'm at. Okay, can you see it? You see the chair? Alright, from a distance, this is what it looks like. See, that's my office. I was there kneeling. Now, right next to that chair is my bed. Okay, so I'm going to show you right there, the bed. Do you see anything? You probably don't, huh? You're probably going, what is he trying to show us? I'm going to show you. When you look at it, doesn't look like much, does it? Doesn't look like much. Now, here's the thing. Directly in front of you is the impression of a snake, a serpent, right? The impression of a snake, a serpent, and perhaps a clan head. Can you see it? Can you see it from where you're at? Can you see it? You probably can't see it, can you? Right here. This right here, see the silhouette? This is a clan, this is a snake head, right here. And if you look at it this way, this is the mouth of the snake, and this is the snake head, and this is a clan head right here, and this is a snake head. Now I'm going to back the camera up a bit so you can have a better look at it. And from a distance, can you see it? Can you see it from a distance? Probably not, huh? You probably can't see it. I mean, I don't know. I can't zoom it in. Do you see it? It's a serpent. It's the head of a serpent. Let's see. Here. It's the double head. It's like a double-headed serpent next to a clan head. Understand? It's a double-headed serpent next to a clan head. I'm not sure if I can show it to you or not. It's kind of hard to see. Let's see here. There's a head, but right next to it is the impression of a snake. And somebody gave that to me this morning. And they pierced me on the top of my left hand. Looks like a pretty big snake, but you can't really tell when you're up close. You have to be far away. And I don't think the camera is actually capturing it, to be quite honest with you. I don't think the camera is actually capturing what it looks like, at least not from this angle. You need a better lens camera. This is with a camera computer, and so it's kind of hard to see. It's a snake head, and it looks like it's coming from the wall. And hold on a second, maybe I could do this. I'm gonna put this here on top of the trash. I'm gonna try to use let's see here. see if you can see it. That's me.
That right there, the white, this is a clean head. But that's a snake impression right there. You can't really see it.
Let's see, maybe if I move the camera.
Can you see it, man?
Yeah, that's it. That's better. That's the head of a snake. Just a little bit closer.
Can you see it now? Right now, do you see it? That right there. You see it now. Now, what I'm gonna need is a stick. So you hold on. I'm gonna need a stick. So that means I'm gonna have to go into the closet. And God forbid that there's the actual thing in the closet. So. This before, but hold on. This right here is a silhouette. That's the top of the head, right? That's the nose. That's the mouth. That's open, right? From this angle. That's the eye. That's another eye. That's the mouth. It's open. Now, when you look at it from this angle, right? It's a double-headed snake. From this angle, that's the head. That's the eye, and that's the mouth that's closed. So when you're standing on the right, the mouth is open. When you're standing on the left, the mouth is closed. You see that? That's what I was given this morning, about 5 o'clock in the morning, while I was praying. And I think that was a warning from the gay community. I just got my SSI check, and they asked me to go and have sex with their men. And I said no, and that was their response. Pretty brutal, huh? Not cool at all. I want to lift the camera up just a little bit. I want to show you something else. Now, so on the right there, that's a clan head. Now, when you lift up the camera, right, when you lift up the camera, you look directly in front. There's that white, there's the drape, right? Just what the drapes are. That's a clan head. I don't know that. The drapes right there on the bed. That's a clan head. The eyes and then the mouth, that's sad. Now the police department didn't want to come and see this. And I guess I don't blame them because I wouldn't want to come and see it either, because if they came to see it, that means they probably took it. So that means they probably be the ones to get hit. But in any case, shocking, huh? Shocking. I wasn't sure what to think about that. I thought that was really interesting this morning to kind of be aroused up, and that's it was kind of weird because when I first got up, the thought entered my mind that there was a snake underneath the bed, and I thought to myself, well, why would there be a snake underneath my bed? And so I dismissed it, and then I went into the kitchen, and then from a distance, I was able to see that image. It's a double-headed serpent. Back in 2010, when I was taken to Western State Hospital after I slugged this guy, I spent some time in jail, for about 40 days in jail for punching a guy because I lost my trailer and my truck. And after I slugged this guy, they sent me up to Western State Hospital. That's the normal practice when a person is incarcerated. They arrest you, make you spend some time in jail, and then take you to Western State Hospital, and then you spend the rest of the time there, about 3 months or so. I mean, there doesn't have to be anything wrong with you, but psychological evaluations and all that crap. And they take you in. Well, anyway, I spent there 3 months. And during the time that I was there, they would come into my room and give me those. You know, they take my sheets and then they turn my sheets either into clan heads or they turn my sheets into snake impressions, like that one right there. So I thought that was interesting. I even called the White House, and I was just like, you know what, these police officers here in Seattle, they didn't want to come up here and take an impression. One of them looked like my banker. I won't say her name, because that's not cool, but I gave it to the police department in case something had happened to me, and of course she would need to know, because I have bank boxes in her bank, and so she would need to know that I'm gone. I think somebody really wants me to either be gay, or somebody really wants me dead. So it's either I'm going to be a fag or dead, but they don't want me teaching the Bible, you know, and be honest with you, as a Bible teaching Christian, that kind of thing is unacceptable, because the Bible says that the snake in the garden was Satan, and he was the animal which God had chosen to put the evil spirit of the angel in. That was the animal that God chose. That was the body in which God chose to put the spirit of that angel in. So God took the angel, put it in the body of a serpent. Basically, that's not the only animal that God has used to put the fallen angels in. He's used pigs, probably donkeys, pretty much all the animals, right? Have even dragons. You go into Revelations chapter 12, there's a big red dragon with seven heads. That one is a double-headed. It's a double-headed serpent. But, you know, the Bible says that God used a dragon with seven heads to embody Satan, right? Because he was such a big angel. And who knows how many other demonic, evil spirits are in that dragon, right? There might be seven evil spirits altogether. But the book of Revelation talks about it. And that inside of the animal, the body, the flesh of the animal, is the evil spirit of the fallen angel. We live in a day and age where Christians are being controlled, manipulated, when they're not being hit, but they're being scared to, there's fear. You know, they use, this is a fear tactic. If you look at this, this is my drawing here. This is, if you look at the photograph or the drawing, this is what you saw. Okay? It's a double-headed serpent. When you look at it this way, see, this is a snake. Can you see it? This is what it looks like this way. And then when you turn it this way, right? You see the snake this way? It's this way. And then it's this way, right? It's going in this direction. See it in this direction. It has its mouth open, but when it's facing down, right? When it's facing down, if you adjust your eyes, it has its mouth closed, and the mouth becomes an eyeball, right? You see? This is what you are looking at. This way, what direction is it going in? This one. It's going in this direction. And when it's facing down, what direction is it going in? It's going down, right? And so that's what you just saw a few minutes ago. This image, this is the image, right? It's a double-headed serpent. This way, and this way. See? That's what you just saw a few minutes ago. And I think that's really interesting that somebody would take that much time to put that there, right? And then right next to it is the head of a clan. Somebody really wants me to, you know, I guess for the Social Security money, or just because I'm a church planner and a preacher, I didn't know that Christianity, I didn't know that Christianity was going to bring this about. And here's the other thing, too. This is what I have in my apartment. I'm going to change the camera here for a minute. When you walk in, look, what does that say? No trespassing. What else does it say? No fags. They bypass those two signs, right? No smoking, no fags, no trespassing. Well, that didn't wear them off. They didn't care about it, and they decided to trespass, and they decided to do whatever it is. Yesterday, I had to call the police because somebody came into the apartment and literally took sexual advantage of my body, and I had to call the police. Actually, I didn't call the police, but I gave it to the White House, a very long, drawn-out letter saying this is unacceptable. Today, instead of taking sexual advantage of me, they did this. I guess that was to give me a warning that I need to stay sexually active. What I think the world doesn't understand is that God is not calling us to sexual activity as Christians. The Bible, right? The Bible says, you know, to sexual activity, you go to 2 Timothy. The Bible says in 2 Timothy, and this is a warning to these people, right? 2 Timothy, 2 Timothy 2, verse 22, the Bible says, "Now flee from youthful lust and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace with those who call on the Lord from a pure heart." I think what these people are doing is they're preparing me, or they're waiting for the right opportunity to give me a demon. You know, that's what a snake is, a demon. And basically the whole point of the demon is to take my life and to kill me. And so they're giving me the opportunity to compromise. You know, if you compromise, we'll leave you alone. But if you don't compromise, then we'll break your neck. Or we'll bite you with a snake. Right? So I have the choice here, the choice of being, having my neck broken by the Klan, or having, or being bitten by a snake. Right? And so the scripture says in 2 Timothy 2:22, flee youthful lust, right? 1 Thessalonians 4, the Bible says, for this is the will of God, your sanctification, that is, you abstain from sexual immorality. The Bible calls the church to abstain from sexual immorality, that each of you know how to possess his own vessel in sanctification and honor, not in lustful passion like the Gentiles who do not know God, and that no man transgress and defraud his brother in the matter, because the Lord is the avenger in all these things, just as we also told you before and solemnly warned you, for God has not called us for the purpose of impurity, but in sanctification. So God is calling his church to sanctification and honor, not to fear and not to submit, right? That's why Christians were eaten up and gobbled up by lions in the first century and second century and throughout the church age. The church have been persecuted to the point where they've been killed and murdered, right? Jesus basically set the standard of what was going to take place. Jesus set the standard of what was going to happen. And basically, we were going to get killed, you know, bitten by snakes, have our necks broken, burned alive, murdered, butchered, because of the testimony of faith, because of the testimony of our Lord. And so, this is just an impression. You only need an impression. You don't need... you know, and the reasoning of the world is, and the reasoning of some Christian leaders, and the reason why they live as homosexuals is because of that right there, right? And as a result of it, this is what happens, right? This is what happens. There's one more passage of scripture. So you've seen 2 Timothy. Paul warns Timothy to flee youthful lust. Paul warns the Thessalonians, abstain from sanctification, and then there's one more. You go to 1 Corinthians 6, the Bible says that, or do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor homosexuals, nor thieves, nor the covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. Such were some of you, but you are washed, but you are sanctified, but you are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and in the Spirit of our God. So here the text says, it's a reminder to the church at Corinth that we were redeemed from that. We were redeemed from that immoral way of life. So that means we don't have to go back into that again. God is calling us to holiness, sanctification, purity. God is calling us to come out of there. In other words, don't run in the same course as these people, right? And so it's a reminder that that was who we were. But we've been washed, we've been sanctified, and we were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and in the Spirit of our God. This is what is difficult for us today to believe, that this has happened. We have been transformed. This is where the faith, the rubber meets the road. Do Christians really believe, right? Do Christians really believe that they've been sanctified? Do Christians really believe that they've been cleansed and purified? Do Christians really believe that they've been washed, sanctified, justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and in the Spirit of our God? Do we believe it? And if we do, do we have permission from the Lord to go and lay in these people's beds and do the things that these people are expecting us to do? Do we have that right in Christ Jesus? And the warning here is that the warning here in Scripture is that we will not inherit the kingdom of God, right? Will not inherit the kingdom of God. It says thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. God will not allow us to be inheritors of his kingdom if we go in this direction. If we go in the direction of being fornicators, deceivers, idolaters, adulterers, effeminates, homosexuals, thieves, covetous, drunkards, revilers, swindlers, we will not inherit God's kingdom. And that's what we were. That's not what we are anymore. And if the world is asking us to live that way, the Lord says, go and make disciples of the world. Preach to them, teach to them, educate them about the Scriptures, right? Educate them about the Word of God. Educate them about what the Bible says, God's position on sexual issue. And after sex, sex becomes slavery, right? That's what happens. You get involved in somebody sexually, and then it leads to slavery. If you yield to them on this level, eventually they're going to ask you to yield to them as a slave, or else they'll give you a snake. If they say yield to us sexually and you do it, then they're going to say yield to us as a slave, or else we'll snake you again. You know, it's like do it or else we're going to give it to you. That kind of mindset is not of God. That kind of mindset is of the devil, right? Because the devil's going to keep going after you. Remember baby Jesus, right, in the story of the birth of Christ. When Jesus was born, Herod, when he heard about it, he went after the baby to kill him, right? And he killed a bunch of babies, according to the Gospels. So he went after Jesus. But then Satan took a couple steps back because God directed Joseph out of the city where they were living in to Egypt. So they went to Egypt to live there, away from the devil, away from Herod the king. Satan waited at least 33 years, right, to test Jesus again. And just as Jesus was about to start his ministry at the age of 30, Satan came out on him a second time and had a scriptural battle. You know, Matthew 4, verses 1 through 9, or verses 1 through 11, Satan had a scriptural battle with the devil again. But this time with the devil, and basically Satan went after him a second time. So Satan went after him as a baby. Satan went after him as a young Hebrew preacher right before he started his ministry. And then 3.5 years later, Satan entered the heart of Judas Iscariot and went after him a third time. And it was at the third time that Satan gave it to him. Right? Satan gave it to him. The first time he didn't touch him. The second time he didn't touch him. But the third time is when he gave it to him. And through Judas, Judas betrayed him. And when Judas betrayed him, he sold him out to the Romans. And the Romans came, arrested him, and crucified him and killed him. So Satan finally got what he wanted, but he had to wait 33 years for it, right? And so the devil, you know, the devil can go after you once, the devil can go after you again, sort of like, and then finally, eventually, boom, the devil is going to strike, because that's the nature of the devil, the nature of the demon inside, the nature of the fallen angels is to keep going after man until man submits. And if they don't get you today, and they don't get you tomorrow, know for a fact that there's a future hit, and God is preparing you for that hit. Now, if for some reason or another, this year, next year, the year after, or sometime in the future, you hear Kevin DeLaron was killed in an automobile accident, because they gave it to me back in 1996, they gave it to me in an automobile accident, and I didn't go then. Another time they tried through suffocation. I didn't go there either. Another time they tried through mace. I didn't go there either. And so those were my three tries. And then I think there might be another future try, because they've been preparing me for it, and that might be it. And so whether it's the clan, or whether it's a snake, or it might be some stabbing, right? It may be something that I'm not even aware of. Right? It could be in medications. You know, you can poison someone. See, here's a cup of coffee here. Looks very innocent, right? But what if there's poison in it? Right? What if there's poison in it? So then you wouldn't even know. Right? And so that's how the devil works. The devil comes and uses man to cause us to stumble. And when we stumble, that's why God gave us his grace. You know, that's why God pours out his grace. If there are Christians out there, Christian leaders, Christian brothers, Christian sisters, that are being coaxed by the devil to yield to sin and to yield to him. Because remember, that was at the end of the second time when Satan went after Jesus, he disclosed what he wanted from Jesus. He wanted submission. He wanted worship. That's what the devil wanted. The devil wanted worship, right? The devil wanted us to worship him. The devil wanted Jesus to worship him. And Jesus said, no, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only, right? And so, be careful out there, Christians. Be very careful, because the devil is not your friend, he's your enemy. And if you're involved in sexual immorality with men, you men out there, and you know that's not your heart, and you know that you have not yielded to the devil, and you women likewise, if you're submitting to sisters, or you're submitting to lesbians, or men in fornication, I know an old woman who has been taken down that road, and she's a fornicator at heart. Years ago, I used to call her mother. Today, she's a fornicator at heart. She's in terrible shape. This woman is in terrible shape. Okay, she has no self-control, and she can't help it. She'll rape you in a minute. Her heart is filled with sensuality and sexuality, and she's 24/7, 7 days a week. That's all that she thinks about. That's all that she's a part of. She's always trying to make a lust connection, you know, like this heart-to-heart thing. And Satan has been using her to try me for years. Years and years and years and years. The woman completely submitted to the devil. She'll even tell you that she's demon-possessed. She'll tell you, she'll testify and tell you that she's a demon, right? And she knows that's who she is. She'll make you feel it. She'll enrage you with her heart. She doesn't even have to say much, but just what she's capable of doing with her heart, what she's able to make you feel, would just shock you. At what's inside of that woman. And I personally think she has a demon, but there's not much that I could do. I couldn't cast it out even if I wanted to. But in any case, you know, you who are watching this video and who knows now what I'm dealing with and what a lot of Christians are dealing with, probably in silence. Oh, there's one other thing. I'm dealing with John MacArthur. You know, John is the pastor that threw me out of his congregation. Under the accusation of being a fag, he He sits in the background and he hisses. I think those are his warnings. I'm not exactly sure why he's taken that position, but maybe those two snake impression might be one from Gabriel and the other one is from MacArthur. They might be the ones doing this. And the clan head, from where I'm standing, looks like the chin of D. Franklin. So I might have been hit 3 times by those 3 people. I'm not exactly sure. And of course, when I got into the apartment, there was glitter. There was green glitter on the floor. And so probably the gay community as well. God is warning you, church. Be careful. We are in the end times. We are at that time where anything can happen. Christians or people you used to think were church members turn out to be devils. Word of counsel, you know, whatever happens, trust in the Lord. I mean, you know, when you look at the Bible, you think, you know, we're the ones who put this together. We translated it in our own language and we wrote it, right? Because it's in our tongue. It's in the English tongue. And it's been given a name and so on and so forth. And so you wouldn't trust a book that's been written by man. But my encouragement is, if you read it, understand God's position on the issue of persecution, on the issue of sex, on the issue of homosexuality, on the issue of judgment, on the issue of Satan. These are all the things that you as Christians should be working through. You remember Paul says to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. And so these are things that you Christians should be working through on a daily basis. The Bible says that those who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus shall be persecuted. Sometimes you might have to drop your guard and do exactly as you're told just to save your skin. Other times you might want to stand your ground. It's up to you. You know where you're at with God. Some days you might say, yeah, I'll go ahead and submit. But other days you may not be able to, because the Spirit of God says no. You're not to submit to these people, and you're not to grieve the Holy Spirit. You're to stand your ground. My encouragement is to always stand your ground. Be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. Because your toil, right, your struggle, your difficulty is not in vain in the Lord. I'm going to let you go now. But keep me in prayer, and I'll keep you in prayer. And remember that greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world.